Hello, 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 hello. Welcome to the live stream. Game development, making Songbringer. It's the 274th day. And the last day was right before Indy Cup. Last week, last Thursday was Indy Cup. What's up, Pedro? And man, got a lot of great feedback, direct and indirect, from people playing Songbringer at Indy Cup. So I got to watch a lot of people in person actually play this game. So that was invaluable feedback. One of the biggest things. Thanks, Pedro. What's up, Boogie? Bafu. Bafu's here too. Yeah, one of the best feedbacks I got. Oh, by the way, I almost won the $10,000 as well. What's up, Pete and Wally? Yeah, so I got picked as the audience choice, and then got to present, and yeah, afterwards the judges came up and told me I did an excellent job, and they had a really hard time not choosing Songbringer to win the $10,000. So I'm not sure what reason they had for choosing the game that they did for the $10,000 winner or whatever, but it was really close. It was really, really close to winning it. So that was awesome. But it didn't matter. What really mattered about being at Indy Cup was simply just, you know, connecting with other people, presenting the game in person, you know, getting that out there. So, but yeah, I got some other, you know, a lot of great feedbacks. Just, you know, I got to watch people play it in person. Yeah, thanks. And watching people play in person, I learned that, first of all, one of the most important things the game needs to do is to be more clear about input. You know, for example, what would happen is a person would play the game a little bit. They play for maybe 10 or 15 minutes, and then they leave the controller and go try it, because there's like 30 other games they can try there. So it's not like you're going to find the most, you know, hardcore fan of your game there. You're probably not. The chances of somebody loving Songbringer is like maybe 1 in 100, 2 in 100. So it's not like you're going to find those kind of people at a small indie event. I probably didn't use the poopy seed. That was it. There are many, many things that caused or no beer. Either one of those would have probably done it, huh? Yeah. If only we could have live streamed it too. Oh, that would have been so cool. I'd like to actually, I should get in touch with the guy that does that tournament, that competition, and let him know that next year he needs the live stream part of it. Seriously. I would have loved, and in fact, if there would have just simply been internet there, I would have live streamed at least for a few hours, because it was pretty neat. Yeah, hopefully there will be some pictures and stuff that come out. There was a video recorded too. So, but yeah, okay, watching people play, I learned that basically it needs to auto-equip items. That's really important, right? So as a person gets a new item, like the bombs or the top hat or whatever, it should always auto-equip that to an empty slot. So the person, you know, if a person doesn't know to press select to go here, at least they'll have the item and be able to use it. Mm-hmm. What's Periscoped it? Oh, is that where the computer records, even though it's not being streamed? Now that you mention it, that easily would have been possible, if that's what you mean. Yeah, well, oh, live streaming from your phone? Oh, wow, I haven't never heard of this. That's another great idea as well. Man, well, next time I'm at a little event like this, I'll know. Wow. So it's Periscope. It's an app. I get it. I gotta check this out later on. This is cool. Man, I'm always learning about stuff. Thanks, you guys. What's up, Arcane? So what was it? Yeah, auto-equipping is really important. Another thing that's really important is I read this one article a while back called The 5 Golden Rules of Input. And I think I'll post a link to that because it's really good. But it should always show what buttons you're using really clearly. So right now, the A, B, X, and Y buttons at the bottom, those are abstract. You know, some people don't have an Xbox controller. Some people have a PlayStation controller. Or some people are going to be using keyboard keys, and they're not necessarily going to use the keyboard key A, B, X, and Y, of course. So if the player is using the keyboard, then it should show the actual keys that they're using for their buttons down there. If they're using an Xbox controller, it'll stay as it is, except that it'll have colored buttons. So, you know, A will be green, B will be red, you know? And then also if they're using a PlayStation controller on a PC or whatever, it should switch to the PlayStation's triangle, square, circle, and all those. Oh my god, wow, that's really interesting. It's not only a great communication, well, it's just a great communication tool in general. Wow, Periscope. I'll have to get that and make sure I use that. Does it work with old phones? Like, I have a 4S, and that thing is slow. I'm not sure if my 4S can handle that, but maybe I'll get a new phone soon. Okay, so first off is to make it so it auto-equips better. You did? You purchased the Stream Controller? So how do you like it? Oh, you haven't tried it. You haven't got it yet. Oh, I'm so interested in hearing how that goes for you. Let's just remember. I need to remember the Steam controller because right now I'm in this whole zone of controllers and all that. So might as well look. Yeah, that's basically what I'm doing today. Yeah, definitely. I want to learn. I want to hear about that. Oh, wow. It's got like touchpads for. Last I saw, this was, oh yeah, so this was totally recent. Yeah, the last I saw, they hadn't finished it. Wow. Are these touchpads? These things? Okay, cool. Well, Periscope will work. I hope it's fast enough, though. All right, here's another one. This really needs to be, okay, but that's interesting. They're also using A, B, X, and Y, and yes, their color scheme is the same. That's good. It's almost like I won't have to change to draw any more buttons to support this. I could just use the Xbox layout. What's up, True Sandwich? How would I make a game launcher like Minecraft's? I don't know. I have never played Minecraft. Yeah. I really haven't. It's just not really my kind of game. But what's their game launcher like? Let me know. Wow. Gutting. You should be reviewing for exams. Right on. Can you do both? Okay, so they're touchpads with haptic feedback. All right. Okay, first thing from the Indie Cup feedback is to make it so it auto-equips items better. So let's get to a point where we're about to get an item. Maybe this one. Maybe we'll just convert this to some item. Yeah, let's do that. Or we can go to a store. Nah, we'll stay here. So I'll make that an item. Let's see, there's diamond cash. It's gonna be an area pattern, wait. No, world maybe. Okay, item, diamond, stash, there it is. Secret items. Oh, there's also a sticker that has that. Yeah. Thanks, Pedro. Thanks for clarifying on that one. Oh yeah, now that you mentioned it, I do remember that Minecraft was made with Java. Okay, I'm just gonna push back, instead of pushing back all of these, I'm gonna just push back bomb container 11. So we have the bomb container right here. in this room, and then we can pick it up and auto-equip it. Right. Well, see, we already have that item. Bomb 11. Oh, we do. Okay, we'll take that away. Should have it on the ground now. We already had bombs equipped though, so let's unequip those. There. So now we've got the situation right, so we can work on the auto equip code for every item. Right now, the auto equip does work for the top hat, but nothing else. Okay, so we've got a bomb on the ground, empty items, empty mappings. It's a big box of bombs. Hey, triple B. I like the alliteration there. Where, that's input system? No, gear system. Where you pick up an item. Here it is. And the same thing that happens when you pick up the top hat, I want to happen for every item. So if, yeah, here it is. This is auto equip. Yeah. Okay. I guess that can be a gear component function, actually. This is really almost the same thing. Okay, so gear. Oh, wait, should it be gear component or should it be gear system? Yeah, gear system. Gear system's always a system. This is because it uses other functions. It's not just pure data, so I should put it in the system instead of the component. We'll call this auto equip. Item. Passing in the int index. Or what are these called? Button index? Good questions, good questions. So yeah, why do you want to make the launcher and what? Me just get on the same page here. Minecraft launcher. Is this it right here? You can see it's got news, choose your version, and then just click play. That's all it is. Yeah, what you would probably do, True Sandwich, to make this is make a separate app. Yeah, so True Sandwich, all you would do is just make a separate application. All it does is whatever you want. Display some news, choose a version, click play. And then when you click play, it launches your actual app. It's just a separate app, man. Real, real easy. Oh, so the first pick's more recent. This one, huh? Oh, okay. It's got a little profile. Same thing. Play button. Profile editor. Version editor. Okay. Yeah, same thing. You would just make a separate app. Yeah. Thanks, Pedro, for the link there. Button index. Gear component has num-equipables. That's what we want. Equipable index. Yeah, so this should be called equip index. And the item, item type item, there. So this will basically just go and use that equipment index to automatically equip that item if there's no, if there's an empty slot. I guess this could loop over both indexes. That's probably not a good idea. Hey, welcome, man. Okay, so there, we'll get that compiling. Gear system, we'll write this function. It's gonna work almost exactly like that. Just a little more fleshed out. Gear system, auto equip. I think it was called auto equip item. Yeah, item. Now, for each one, actually, no, there's not even need to be each one. Oh, I guess we do need a gear component here. Well, you fixed a memory leak? Wow. Oh no. Oh no, dude. What's BSOD again? Oh, blue screen. Yeah, blue screen. Blue screen it. So I totally changed my mind. This should be a gear component method. It's just two gear component and E. We got auto equip item, index item. Yeah, isn't that funny? Right? The language has garbage collection. You use it, doesn't work as good as you think, so you have to end up having to collect your own garbage anyways. That's irony, right? That's irony. If equip index. See, now this function is way more simple. So if it equals none, we equip it, we set it to ready, and then we change the image. Oh no. Oh, that sucks, Pedro. Yeah, oh, and now there's no record that it happened? Did it really happen? No. It didn't even happen. So how about this? If it's not equal to none, we'll return here. There, now we've got less indents. more changeable modular code. Yeah. Now we can auto equip the top hat, auto equip bombs. All that's going to happen in gear system. Here's where we do it with the top hat. We go e.gear.autoequip. KB. KItem. Artist item.type. There. Okay, let's verify that works as well. So unequip it. Okay, take away from the player. Change what we're creating in the world. Oh, you know what? This should auto-equip to any index, not just one. Lunax, what's up, man? Welcome to the stream. Can you use the Windows programming language on Xcode? What do you mean? There's lots of different programming languages that run on Windows. Are you talking about C++? Okay, that did auto-equip it to B, but that's not what we need. We need to auto-equip item to any equip index. Gear component, once again, we got to take away auto-equip item index, just item. There. And a gear component, CPP. Take away the equip index and loop over all equip indexes. C sharp, for example, no, you cannot use C sharp with Xcode. You would need to use either Unity to use C sharp, or I think Monogame runs on Mac now somehow. Yeah, so sorry, man, you can't use C sharp really in Xcode natively. Oh wait, can you? As a version 2.8, mono develop, yeah, support. Oh, there you go. You can. Wow, I never knew that. Yeah, you can use C++, C. Man, what other languages does Xcode support? Of course, Objective-C and Swift. Gutting, what's that? Split your source files? In C++, yeah. There, so we've already equipped one. We just continue. Otherwise, we equip it and return. I guess this thing should return true if it does. Return false if it doesn't. Okay, one more thing to change to make this method a little more awesome. I'll return a bool here. Just so in the future, if I ever want to check if it did equip, I can. There. And now back to gear system. We're gonna auto equip item type. Yeah. All right, bombs, same thing. Oh, see, I was already mimicking that code right here with bombs. But that's not very smart. So let's, oh, that's bomb. That's just the regular bomb, not even the bomb container. So diamond 5, life. We don't need to equip any of those. Those are just quantity items. Life container, same thing. Bomb container, though, we do want to auto-equip bombs. Key map, same thing. I'm just going to put it right after the clamp. It makes more sense there. Life container, bomb container, key. Yeah. We equip those. Maps as well. Here's another one where I was trying to mimic that behavior there. We'll get rid of that. Why doesn't Unity still use mono? Isn't C Sharp already cross-platform? I do not think it is. But I don't know. I'm not very familiar with C Sharp and all of its intricacies. Okay, so this time, it should automatically equip the top hat. I should have a sword. See, I've got nothing right now, not even a sword. Oh, it's just not equipped. So if I do this, it should be, yeah, it's equipping to the sword button. Okay, so problem there, but the problem can be solved. In fact, probably it's best to just go auto-equip items, starts with KV. So now, for some reason, I've got my sword unequipped, but at least I can. So I could throw that. Oh. So now, we need to have the sword equipped. Let's make sure everything still works. And then we'll try out bombs. Equipped, no problem. So we'll save it there and now make it so the world forces that item to be bomb container 11. We'll pick up the bombs and it should auto equip. got the X button. Oh, we have no bombs at all. Oh, it shouldn't auto-equip the bomb container. Hold on a second. Gear system. That's a bug for sure. Bomb container. Alright, bomb container should not equip the bomb container, but the bomb. Hey, so for anybody that just joined the stream, welcome back. This is the 274th day making Songbringer, and I'm just getting back after a weekend off. And last week I was at IndieCup presenting this game to gamers and other game developers and presenting it on stage and stuff and competing to win a $10,000 prize. So I learned a lot. Learned a lot about what the game needs to be a little clearer, a little just really just easier to understand. What's up, Blood? Hello, people of Earth. How is your kind doing? So one of the things was that it should always auto-equip items, so a person doesn't have to know that they need to go to their inventory and equip bombs whenever they get one, right? A person that's just brand new to this game, has never played this game before, is not going to get that unless it just makes it easy for them. And another thing, it should show on this little item screen right here where it says bomb container, maximum bomb cubes, blah, blah, blah. It should show the button that it auto-equipped to. Yeah, IndieCup was great, Blood. Yeah, not only did it win the audience choice, so basically there during the event there was already 7 picked finalists, and then there was another one that the audience got to choose at the day of the event. So Songbringer got picked as the audience choice, and that means I got to present it on stage, and that went really great. And afterwards, the judges came up and said, "Hey, we loved your presentation. It was really hard not to pick your game." So it was. Songbringer was really close to winning the $10,000 that day. And then we already established it was probably because I didn't use the World Seed Poopy. Nice, this is an indie. Oh, I get it. This is an indie cup. That's right, it is. Alright, so now that I've got this all working, I'm going to equip these other items. And then we'll add a little icon. Oh, thanks, Gunning. You saying this code looked clean? Crazy. Looks dirty to me. Not enough comments. This is a AAA cup. Yep, it totally is. Look at that little perfect design on top. Compass. Auto-equip? Yes. Oh, here is map, auto-equip, compass, auto-equip. Bell, no. Diamond stash, no. Life container quarter, no. Unlock exits, no. Everything else, yes. If it's an equipable item. So if gear, component, gear component is equipable, item.type1, then we're gonna auto equip it. There, so now we've got every item that can possibly be equipped is going to automatically be equipped whenever you pick one up for the first time, if you've got an empty slot. So that'll really help people play this game at the very beginning when they're just acquiring items. They just, you know, you have no clue what to do except for swing the sword. Here, at least now you're swinging the sword. You're the top hat will be automatically equipped and everything else nicely equipped. So let's test it one more time. Make sure this still works. And then I think it's ready to check in. You bought Black Ops 3? Why are you ashamed? Oh, because of the AAA part? Don't be ashamed. If you like a game, you like a game, man. Yeah, I gotta admit, that was really nice. Really nice, then I have to go into inventory and equip that. Cactus would be the same thing, I would think. Let's make sure the cactus works, actually. Let's have... Well, it's not equipped, so... World, we'll make this the... make this a cactus. Nice. Do a conditional check to see if you have more than two items. Why is that? Oh, it doesn't like this. Oh, because I already have one, maybe? Yeah, so Pete and Wally, why would I do that? Why would I do a conditional check to see if you have more than two items? Thanks, man. Right? I know, yeah. I know. And, you know, I realized a lot about competitions, especially with indie games. You know, indie game competitions put the developers in a state of mind of that we're all against each other. So that part kind of sucks, you know? When you're at any kind of competition like this, the inherent attitude of all the developers there, which may or may not be the core people that are at such an event, are all kind of against each other rather than for each other. And I think that's unwise, because as indie game developers, as you create a game, it finds its own following. It doesn't matter if your game is almost like another one or similar in genre to another one. You're still going to have your own audience, your own unique fan base. So it sucks that there can only be one winner at such events. And it sucks that the competition breeds sort of this fear almost. Oh, I don't want to share, you know, any secrets with that guy or whatever. So I don't know. I would like to see an event kind of like Indie Cup where more people felt like they would win. You know, maybe there's smaller prizes for some people, or just kind of echoing the reality that all of our games have unique followings. If more than two equipable items, then you don't need the auto-equip code anymore. Why not? Pete and Wally, the whole point of this is to equip items into empty slots. So even if a person already has two of the item and you have an empty slot, I want it to auto-equip this. But it is... I see what you mean. I see what you mean. But I think I'm going to stay on this side of the fence with this particular choice, because... I want it to auto equip if there's any kind of empty slot. Right? Yeah. Yeah, it was a great place to mingle. And I mean, and a lot of great things that I didn't realize about the competition before. So next time I go to a competition, I'll really know what to expect. But basically, you know, getting direct feedback from people was amazing, right? Having people come and play the game all day and just watch them play, watch what happens when they play. And that's why I'm doing this right here, you know, all these little things to help with the input and help people understand the game. That's the thing. When I found myself trying to talk to people that are playing the game, when I found myself explaining things, I'm like, why am I trying to explain the game to them? Shouldn't the game explain itself to the player? So that was kind of like my trigger flag to note something down. Like, okay, I wanted to explain to the player that they should equip the top hat. Shouldn't the game figure that out somehow? How to, you know, I should explain to this player right now that they can press select to open up their inventory. You know, the game should show them that somehow a little bit. You know, not too much guidance, not too much tutorialness, but like enough that I wouldn't have to explain myself if somebody came up to my booth at an indie competition or a GDC or any kind of trade show. So yeah, cactus worked great. Let's go back to bomb containers. And all right, now I want to do some icons. And actually, yeah, this is ready to check in, except for this. Auto equips the same item twice. Oh, Pete and Wally. Oh, good point. Good point. This code should do that. Hold on. Okay, so is that what you meant the whole time? I'm sorry, I didn't quite understand. Yeah, so if we already have this thing equipped to something else, return. So if equip index is item, return false. Already equipped. Good point, Pete and Wally. Thank you, man. Whoops, it's supposed to be I. Right? Yeah, you took you 10 minutes of wondering if you can get a bigger map until you press all the buttons. Yeah. Exactly. Yeah, there needs to be something there that shows you how to get into your inventory. If Quake was done today. Yes, totally. Right. It's playing all these ads for different companies. Oh my god. But this movie's funny. Oh, yeah. I gotta watch this video actually all the way out later on. Yeah, I will. I'll watch that whole thing later on. Yeah, right on, Blitzslime. Yeah, Boogie, right. That's a good thought. So during this whole screen right here, when you pick up an item, it'll first tell you what it auto-equipped it to. So, like, right now I'm picking up the bombs. It should say on this screen, press the B button. To use the bombs, or the X button, whatever. And it should also say, press select to open up your inventory. Both those things should be on this little screen right here. Maybe in smaller text. Okay, and once again, Pete and Wally, thanks for that. That's really important there. All right, so let me check this in now. Oh, this is world CPP. Don't need this bit. Great. And I can check over all this code and then check it in. So we got this auto equip function. It's a lot smarter than the old way it was auto equipping just the top hat. So much better method. And then that method is used for a lot of different item types, like bombs, cactuses, that kind of stuff. Yeah. Auto equip all equipable items, if possible. All right, next thing, let's work on these screens and stuff. Okay, I need pictures, I need images for all types of items or item buttons. I'm gonna put these on the HUD. This is kind of a huge image to work on, but I think this is the right place, the HUD image. What's up, why not? Happy holidays. All right. I'm going to turn on the background for a moment. Okay, now I'm going to draw some buttons and stuff. So the size of each button should be something like this, maximum. We're looking at maximum a height of 10, probably more like a height of 8. So 10 by 10 or 8 by 8 is going to be the typical size for these things. All right, so I'm going to draw some Xbox style buttons first. There's also going to be some PlayStation style buttons. And so a little keyboard looking button. All right, I gotta find the right layer. This is the complex part about this image. It's got so many layers, but these are all used for important stuff. Yeah, let's put it at the top. Button A. So we need a blue color. Like the same blue color as the Xbox blue. NES buttons, Genesis buttons, Atari buttons, Game Boy buttons. We need all of them. Every kind forever and ever and ever. This is the new one. This is the same one. About, yeah. So one thing I noted at the Indie Cup was actually that most people are using Xbox controllers. That much I already expected. But I was also quite surprised to see a lot of people still using PlayStation, or not still, but a lot of people are using PlayStation 4 controllers on their computers. So, I didn't know you could use a PlayStation 4 controller with your computer, but of course I don't know a lot of things about my own industry. So here's the color of blue. Huh. What if I just took this little image and made it small? Let's see what that looks like. So we'll start with A. It'll be ugly, don't do it. Barack Obama buttons, what? Oh, yeah. Don't do it. Wow, Pedro, interesting to note that. So Windows, you need an additional software. It's the exact opposite for Xbox controllers. Oh, and you just mentioned that. Yeah. So I did not know that. That's really interesting. Uh-oh. Okay, there it goes. I accidentally bumped the cord. Did not like that. Okay, so I'm gonna try this thing small. It were 8 pixels by 8 pixels. Nearest neighbor. Yeah. And let's try reducing the number of colors as well. So right now we got 53 colors. Max of maybe four, five, six, maybe. Seven actually looks pretty good. Yeah, seven was pretty good. Hey, what's up, TM? Yeah. Oh. Yeah, I'm not gonna use, I can't use 16 by 16 because it's not gonna fit. This is that old school 8-bit style graphics. Yeah, it would take less time to draw a circle and add an A in it, but I want it to look like an Xbox controller's image. RGB. I'm gonna clean it up a little bit. In my ship, the Rosinante. There, I like that. I like that a lot. Okay. Got one of these done. A done. All right, good night, Pete Wally. Don't need that. We can paste this guy. Got the A. Ooh, I don't like the bottom. There we go. I like that. Yeah, I basically did just go from scratch by redrawing all that, but I like how it turned out. So let's get the next button. Hey. All right, next one. Just clean this one up too. All right, there we go. Another one. Yeah. So what I like about this is that they look like Xbox controller buttons, but yet they're very low res. I'm definitely getting the impression that these are Xbox controller buttons. They have sort of this shine of, being somewhat transparent on top. So that's coming through pretty nicely with the way the coloring turned out like that. So, Blood, how's it going with everything with Google and stuff? So this one's the Y, huh? This one definitely needs some adjustment. BitSlime, am I allowed to use this image? Isn't it subject to copyright? That's a great question. I've researched this a little bit, so and I'm just a person. I'm not really like, I'm not a lawyer or whatever. But from what I understand, if you take an image and you change it more than 20% or something like that, it becomes fair usage. You've changed it enough to be your own unique image. So for this image right here, this image, yes, might be subject to copyright law, right? Like I would not be able to go and use this image. And also you can't use people's trademarks. So that would be like a trademark, this X thing I'm probably, so I wouldn't be able to use that. But as far as this image goes right here, I could use this image if I change it enough. So by pixelating it and making it way smaller than it was, I've already made it my own art, So that's then look up the fair use laws, look up copyright laws and images and stuff. You should really do your own research on this and not just trust what I'm saying because I might be totally wrong about this. But from what I understand, if you change an image enough, it counts as your own creation. Yeah. Nice. Tomorrow? Yeah. 5 hour news from the factory? Oh, dude, that's great. Yeah. Awesome. So, did you announce it on your own? How did you guys do the announcement and all that? Okay. XPixel, what's up? What am I using this for? I'm using it in the game to represent the exact buttons that you'd use. So if you're using an Xbox controller, it's going to show you in Xbox controller terms. Headlong into mystery. Maybe this one actually needs. No. Yeah. Okay, that one's done. Nice. Okay, so they did the announcement right on. Cool, dude. Dude, so awesome. So for anybody who doesn't know, Vlad is part of a company that I don't want to say it wrong, but he's doing some amazing things for the world. I know, even number pixels. It's gotten me so many times in all this artwork. But that's what's beautiful about the challenge of very small pixels or very big pixels, however you want to look at that. The challenge is how do I express this thing here with that few pixels? I'm gonna make this index color again. Oh yeah, how did Ludum Dare go? Forgot all about that. It's a busy weekend for me. Ludum Dare. I think Rocket Bunny's doing it. If I'm correct. Rocket Bunny did the last one. I think he's doing this one too. Oh, there was two themes this time, huh? Flame War. Awesome. One game a month, Pedro? Cool. This one's kind of a challenge. Nice. Oh, cool. All right. Here's TMs. Two button controls, comma, growing. Interesting. Oh, it was a tie on the theme, huh? This one's called The Crunch. This is one. This is yours, right? The Crunch? Dude, I love how it plays in my browser or in my on my iPad. Yeah. Cool. It's a fly trap. So what theme did you go with? Growing? Cool. Yeah, it works on the iPad. I don't know if I could actually input on the iPad, but it did run just then, and really quickly too. Why did it become a lowercase b? Dude, good question. How did it do that? This is one of those choices too, where it's like, okay, do I keep it that way or not? Because now it's an 8. This was luck. This is pure luck. But you know what? I haven't even tried this in the game. This needs to be put in very quickly, like as in right now, so I can see if this is even right. Yeah, let's start it right now. And then we could draw all the rest of the buttons and stuff as if they're, because I might need to make these bigger. I might actually go with 10 by 10. If necessary. So all these need to be individual layer-based slices. I got slices now. The name of these. HUD button. A. This A. I don't know which one I clicked on. All right, we're ready to export. Nice. Failzan, welcome to the stream, man. And I like what you did, man. I like that you started at Ludum Dare, but then you were like, you know what? I need a little bit of more time. And you just decided to take longer. It's cool. Most people would think inside the box on that one, be like, oh my God, I gotta finish it by in 48 hours. Oh, but you didn't. Instead of focus, yeah, I think you're focusing on the right thing there, man. Good job. Not that I'm right or anything. I'm just saying, I'm just trying to be encouraging. All slices, all user slices, sheaths, HUD, save, replace all. Oh yeah? Yeah, good man. Cool. Whoa. That was a lot of repacking. Okay, I need to go into code mode for a second and make it so the buttons are. Yeah, one game a month is a lot. There's already one of those competitions, right? The one game a month competition. What's that game a month? One game a month. Yeah, onegameamonth.com. This is what you're talking about, right, Pedro? These are cool. Wow, Failzan, you got a lot of these. Congrats, man. You got a Solitude, Prometheus, Dungeon Raider. Wow. Factory Vor, Slime Factory, Dinolution, Stranded, and Alone in Space. Alone in Space and Dungeon Raider, I'm immediately attracted to because they're sort of the perspective that I love to play. Cool, man. Whoa. This is a 48-hour game. I'm impressed. Even if it's not any kind of Ludum Dare style. Wow. Good job. One game in 6 months is enough of a challenge. For me, it's like one game in 2 years. Nice. The lighting from scratch as part of the dare. Whoa. Are we doing on time? Oh, we got 45 minutes left. Awesome. I might be able to get this done today. Okay, we got buttons now. We need a function that you say, okay, I want the equipable index A. But that might be a different image on different platforms. So the game needs to keep track or input. I guess the input class could keep track of the last input device. So input dot, I checked all this in, right? Yeah, that's good enough. Okay. Yeah. Or in, maybe input dot h. Yeah. So, okay, input on H is going to have its own input device types. Well, there you go. Yeah, I mean, it's not dynamic, but it's still awesome. I guess just input type's fine. Input type K input keyboard. That's always the default. Input controller Xbox. We're also going to have controller PlayStation. And I guess we'll also, we might have a controller MISC. And then the input class itself, this is a singleton. This thing should have a function that gets the latest, get the input device type, or input type, whatever. Game devs like music. Sometimes you jam, sometimes you really work on it. Both are good. Ah, highly agree, highly agree. Jams can be really effective for meeting people as well. You can meet a team that way. You can meet artists. You can meet other musicians. You can meet other coders. Or maybe you're an artist or a musician and you need to find coders. It's a great way for people to meet each other, you know? And then not only do you get to meet those people with the Ludum Dare Jam, but you get to work with them too. So I think it's a great connector of people. Thanks. Thanks, Vilzen. Yeah, the balance has come from doing lots of releases, you know, like having to do the release technically for the Indie Cup, you know, it made me really step up the game. And that's also going to make me get another release out this month for updating the alpha. So, and then there'll be another release for the beta and then probably a beta update and then the final version. So yeah, it has really helped. It has really helped to do it that way because it breaks up the time that I would normally spend, you know, polishing the game into just one little or many, many chunks rather than one huge chunk of time, which can get really hard and really, you know, you get really burnt out quick if you're doing all of your polishing in one chunk of time. So we've got get input type, and then we also need a function. Of area, or no, game scene. That's the show HUD label, set items, set cacti, hazmat pause. This one, static void, set input type. So when the input type changes, we can change the graphic really quick for this. Set input type. And the last thing we need is a function that actually gets the sprite frame given. Given an input type. Which would make sense to put inside this method as well, or inside here. So I'll put it here, right by that same function. Set input type, and then we also got static string get input type image. So given an input type, and an index. Oh no, this should be a button. Yeah, button index or button type. Make a cup of Java. Thanks, man. Cool. Thanks, Belzin. Appreciate it, man. You already got glasses? button index. What are these? This input.h. Yeah, these are unnamed. So this is this button index. So whether that's up, down, left, right, select, start, whatever, we can get an image for it given an input type. So there, we compile all those, and create these methods, and then get them to work so we can display them on in the right places. Yeah, so it's Bluetooth low energy, sweet. Whoa, you got, wow. Dang, dude. It sounds like you've been hauling ass. Wow. Why'd you have to read write it? Oh, there's a better, you realize there's a better way to do it. Yeah. Wow, cool. I like that. That's bold. You're just like, you know what? There's a better way. Delete everything. Start over. First method, input.h. We need a get input type. We'll have a static. We'll call this one current input type. Man, now that I wrote this, I want to rewrite that to these input type. There. Okay, so we got a current input type, and Rocket Bunny would approve. I know, I just want to see the chug of milk, yes. I know, I want to see the buttons in the game too, right? All this code just to get this working. Nice. So you're really happy with the third version. Cool. All right. So this needs a little bit of code to whenever a certain kind of input is used, it's going to switch the current input type to that. So if it gets a Where should I put this? Oh, here's on key released, on key pressed. And then also the input controllers. See this thing. Yeah, set held controller code is actually a pretty good place to put this. And then this set held controller code. Oh, it doesn't use this at all. Or held key code. Ah, it does set it right here. So on key pressed, we're going to go input, current input type. Okay, input type keyboard. And then set input type. If held key code is greater than or equal to kmin gamepad code, then input type Actually, no, this is wrong. Input needs a function, even if it's a private function. But it won't be. So static void set input type. All right, Pedro, good night, man. Have a good one, dude. What? PC Warrior. Ah, oh, really? That's funny. All right, now also in input controllers need to, whenever we press a button, we set the held controller code, we also want to set the input type. So this will be able to switch at runtime, it can switch what device is current. So if the player switches from the keyboard and starts using their controller, no problem, it'll update all the images. And here's where we need to differentiate the controller type for this current device. All right, so we're gonna set a map of, man, sorry, this is getting so long and complicated just to show these buttons, but these are necessary. So we'll have a map of input types, and it's gonna be, this is device hash. So given a device hash, we can know what input type it is. Here's where it sets up the manager and creates stuff, create input system. Destroy manager, get device hash. Steve Tramby, what's up, man? Howdy, dude. What's up, PMC? Hey, the event went really great, man. Yeah, it was really cool. Indie Cup. It was a small event, but what was so great is I got to see so many people play the game in person. That was invaluable. And so today I'm working on things to improve the game that is going to make it better for people that are just starting to play this game. Steve Tramby, how you been, man? One of these things is it's going to show you, one thing I've already done today is to make it to auto equip. So when I get this item here, it's going to automatically equip bombs to the X button because the X was free. So The next thing I'm doing is I'm going to actually show what button it's bound to. So on this little screen right here where it says bomb container and shows the bomb container, it says what it does. It's going to show also what button to use, and also it's going to say press select if you want to rebind that or remap it. Yeah, totally. In-person testing. Yeah, it's like no other kind of testing. Yeah, it was. It was really cool. And another great thing about it was that I almost got chosen for the $10,000 prize. It was pretty neat. Just to even get to display my game on stage and talk about it and stuff. That was awesome because the game got to be the audience choice. So the audience chose Songbringer as their finalist choice. I'm pretty proud of that. So, yeah. It was a great thing. I also got to meet some great people in the industry here in San Francisco that I did not even know about. I was like, whoa, 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 you're this person, you're that person, and got it. It was cool. So I'm working on the code behind all this right now where it's going to auto-detect what device you're using. Thanks, Steve. And yeah, so if you're using your keyboard, it'll know that, okay, the player's playing with the keyboard. If you actually have an Xbox controller and you're playing with that, it'll know that as well. So here's where it gets the vendor type. This is where it's going to detect whether it's an Xbox controller or something else. I think at the end of all this, it does something where it sets up the controllers. All right, I think it's here, setup controllers. Yeah, there it is. If the sticks are different. Joystick event arg, it's gonna be arg device vendor. Okay, the first joystick, we'll just set that to be the, all right, I guess we can do all of them. So I think joysticks I should have a vendor. Yeah, it does. We have a standard string vendor. Cool. Okay, I want to see what that does for, or what the vendor ID is for. How many joysticks does OIS support? I think it supports infinite, if I'm wrong. Pretty sure that's right. How will you know what the button looks like outside Xbox, PlayStation? Yeah, so I don't know what I'm going to do for the miscellaneous ones. For now, I'm just going to leave it as the Xbox one, because a lot of other devices out there are kind of using that A, B, X, Y scheme. The Super Nintendo-esque one I have is like that. So I think for miscellaneous controllers, it's just going to be the Xbox layout for now, or the Xbox icons. Yeah, so we do a vendor ID here, and we can get a device hash. Oh, this is, dang. Tricky, tricky, tricky. So I want to map the device hash to a string or to an input type. So whenever you press a button, it knows it's got the joystick event. I guess I can just set the function or set it right here. Yeah. How many joysticks can a woodchuck chuck? If a woodchuck chuck could chuck, a woodchuck could chuck wood, All right, here we'll clear out the input types. We'll make a function called getInputType. Given a device hash. Or no, we want to be given a device. Oh, device and. I guess just device. Yeah, this argument here is fine. All right, so if arg dot device, let's get the vendor first. So a vendor contains the string. I think it's just like Xbox or whatever. Yeah, it's just a visual, yeah. It's like this. So basically I'm just created these buttons here. And I want whoops. Show slices, there we go. So I created the buttons and now I just want to show them. That's all. So yeah, it shouldn't be too bad, right? I can use these for most all generic types. And then, or maybe maybe create some colorless versions, I guess, for generic. I don't know. So I'm going to get the device hash for the current device. If the vendor contains Xbox, actually, if we'll look in the current map of input types. So if it found it, yeah, hopefully. All right, TM, see you, man. So otherwise, we're gonna. So if it contains Xbox, yeah, hopefully. What's up, Chugga Beer? Uncle Poo. yeah, I am too. So yeah, if we've got the word Xbox in the vendor, actually, let's make that lowercase as well. Dang, I thought I made a two lower method. Well, I'm not going to worry about this. Wait, did I? Kit.h. Lowercase. Oh, there it is, lowercase. Okay, yeah, so using the lowercase method, now it's a little more bulletproof. There, if we've got the word bullet Xbox, we've got an Xbox controller. I don't know if this is right or whatever for PlayStation. It might be PS. Actually, maybe we can find that. PlayStation controller vendor string. No, no luck. What's up, Google? Come on, Google. Lame. It might be PS. But I'll leave that like that for now. So we've got the word PlayStation. We're going to use a PlayStation controller graphics. Otherwise, it's going to default for now to the Xbox controller. So, and then we want to set it to the map, input types, hash equals type, and return type. Set a breakpoint here so we know this is going to work. Oh, this now needs to be a non-const method. That's fine. Should be. So let me review this code before I run it once. We're getting the device hash from the joystick event, and then we're looking for it in the input types. If it's found, then it returns that. Otherwise, it tries to ferret out what controller type this is based on the vendor string. It takes that vendor string lowercase and looks for the word Xbox or PlayStation. Else it just uses Xbox, stores it into the cache, returns that type. So every time a button is pressed, it's going to set the input type. So we're going to input, set input type, this, get input type based on the joystick event. Also, if an axis is used, axis moved, yeah, if an axis is moved, we do the same thing. Same thing with POV. There we go. Okay, so we should have all the methods in place now to set the input type. Now we need to apply them in the game scene. So the game scene has a method now to set input type and get input type image. So we need to fill out those two methods and use them, and then we're good. And put those right after set cacti. Oh, the stream's gone? Sorry, guys. Oh, it looks fine here. Oh, same for you? Let's see. Did it reset? No, it didn't even reset. Yeah, set input type is just going to get the current input image. Well, it works again. Yay! Yay! Nice. Okay. I don't know what's up. Nice. All right. Good. Okay. So we've got all these methods working to get the input type from the input class. Now we need to actually apply it in the HUD. So I guess I could do a static of the old type, static. Actually, we'll just do static int, old type equals -1. If the current type is not equal to the old type, actually, if it equals the old type, then return. Now, old type equals type, and we're going to loop over all the current buttons. And set the icon. I got confused there because I was like, man, what am I going to do about keyboard input? Keyboard input is a label. I want to actually draw a label with the letter A or whatever. And then other controller things are buttons or images. So they're like the A button on an Xbox is an image. So both those are different. I guess for now, I'll just do images and I can add labels later. Or maybe make, I don't know, combine them somehow. I'll do finish this method first. So I'm gonna switch the input type. Let's just do the PlayStation or the Xbox controller. All right, so button A. This is HUD. What did I call these? HUD button B. So now we can get the actual image given the current type and the button index, which is K button A plus I. Now we have image dot size is greater than 0. We can set the image. Which means we need 4 new images. We need 4 new images for all these buttons. We've got HUD item A, B, X, Y. We also need the HUD button X. All right, so now all these two, these need to be all created. So they'll start with just a pixel, they're empty. And after all this is, after we do all this, we need to remember to call set input type based on the current input type at the very beginning of the game. Or input, get input type there. Oh, and also input.cpp, if it happens to set an input type that's not equal to the old input type, it needs to call game scene set input type. Okay. Should be good. Now we just need to set up these buttons to be right. So set scale pixel, set anchor point, set position. Positions are going to be wrong. Probably wrong by 6 or 7 pixels to the left, so maybe this should be 226 or so. Okay, where is that set item type again? Or set input type? Here we go. Image size is greater than 0. just want to do one for now. That's all we got created. So if we're doing K button A or actually just zero here. So if we have a node, an image, so the sprite frame name, given the image. Oh, and this is node. Node set sprite. Actually, this needs to be sprite. Whew. All right, I think that should be all we need, huh? Should. Okay, if this doesn't crash, then we might have an Xbox icon. Oh, it looks like it just messed up the sword. Well, the stream's kind of been funny anyways. I think we're 2 hours anyway. So, well, I guess that's it for today's stream. I almost got it there working, but what I'm intending to do next is to get it so it's got an Xbox icons, if I'm using the Xbox, down there where it says A, B, X, and Y on the bottom of the screen on the HUD. It's going to actually use the Xbox icons there, or else use little keyboard keys to show their keyboard keys, or else show PlayStation controller buttons or whatever. So that's what's next on the list, and it'll also say it here. When you pick up an item, it'll say use this button to use it, and press select if you want to remap it. So yeah, that's it for today's stream. Thanks everybody for watching. If you still are, I think the stream's acting really crazy right now. My chat hasn't updated in a while. So anyways, if you guys are even seeing this, good night. Have a good one. Appreciate y'all. And I'll be back tomorrow at the same time, Wizard 30. See you, everybody.